Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Joel Rosen. I am an adrenal fatigue recovery ninja, and I want to welcome you back to another edition of your Adrenal Fix. I know it's been a while since the last time I talked to you, but today I want to talk to you about the steroid hormone pathway, the stress response, pregnenolone steel, and what a saliva sample ultimately should look like. So let's say we have adrenal fatigue, we're exhausted, we have no libido, we don't have any sex drive, we have a lot of energy deficiencies, we don't feel like we're restoring ourselves, we don't feel like we're vibrant, we don't feel like we have a lot of vigor and strength, and we just don't have that nice hormonal balance that's necessary to handle the day-to-day stressors. So what I'd like to do is discuss the hormone pathway and explain to you where things go awry and what you should be able to do to try to fix that. So first of all, let's talk about cholesterol. Cholesterol is the top of this steroid hormone pathway, and cholesterol gets such a bum rap. Many doctors feel that the lower the cholesterol, the better. You know, many, many years ago, the high range was 320, and then, you know, miraculously, Pfizer comes up with a patent to make cholesterol-lowering medication, and now, for some reason, the mandated high end of cholesterol on a blood test is 200. And so it gets lower and lower and lower over the years, making the necessity for cholesterol-lowering medication higher and higher and higher. And at the end of the day, the drug companies make billions of dollars, and then you suffer because you have too little cholesterol to help make hormones happen in your body. And so that you have these lack of focus, lack of strength, lack of libido, lack of energy, lack up of getting up and going, and it's really a shame. So that's my job, is to try to point out how this impacts your health and namely your adrenal function. So cholesterol should be somewhere between 200 to 240 to 260. Cholesterol in and of itself is not the problem. The problem is inflammation. So if we have high inflammatory markers like uric acid or homocysteine or insulin or hemoglobin A1C, or ferritin, or other different reactions in the body that indicate, or C-reactive protein that indicate inflammation, then obviously the more cholesterol you have in the body, the worse off you're going to be, because cholesterol likes to deposit itself on inflamed vessels. However, if we have low inflammatory markers, our homocysteine levels are normalized, our A1C levels are normalized, our insulin levels are normalized, our ferritin levels are normalized, our uric acid and C-reactive protein levels are normalized, then having a nice, robust, you know, level of cholesterol is going to be very, very helpful for you to be able to make hormones. So things like healthy fats, healthy oils, coconut oils, avocados, even olive oil, if it's not heated, because it doesn't heat well. And the important thing about the oils is they need to be in a sunlight-proof container, whether that's a plastic container that's not BPA sprayed, or it's in a glass container that's darkened, or a metal container that's not contaminated. Then that can really shield off the sunlight from the oils that will rancidify that oil, which is a whole other topic. But either way, we should be getting a healthy representation of fatty acids that are in our meals in order to allow us to make enough cholesterol to make our hormones. So what happens is getting a nice amount of cholesterol in our meals, and you'll even see as research comes out that cholesterol was a big problem over the years, in that we were telling you not to eat any cholesterol, when in fact cholesterol is necessary. So hopefully you get that idea. Cholesterol goes into pregnenolone, and pregnenolone is a metabolite or a hormone that has a lot of different choices to make. And the example I use is, imagine we have a wine glass here, and it's a wedding, and it's channeling down, and in optimal health, it will go and it will filter into all of these different necessary metabolites or sex hormones. However, when demand starts to go up in terms of stress responses, then we'll start to see a skewing of this entire pathway. And so what happens is pregnenolone can go into DHEA, or pregnenolone can go into progesterone, which ultimately makes cortisol. And so when we have a high stress life, the demand goes up. And typically, the supply stays normal or supply goes down. And so when our demand goes up, then the demand to make cortisol goes up. And so what are some of the demands? Unstable blood sugar. So if our blood sugar goes too high or too low, if we wait too long between meals, we're having too much stimulants and caffeine and sugary foods, and we miss a meal and we waited too long between one meal to the next, that's going to cause the demand for cortisol to go up. Anemias, if we're not absorbing nutrients, if we are B vitamin deficient, we have genetic issues, methylation issues, iron deficiencies, bleeding inside the body, or other genetic problems, anemia is going to create a higher demand for cortisol. Other things like food sensitivities or leaky gut, so having a lot of inflammation in the body because you're reacting to foods and that's creating inflammation in the gut, or having unhealthy bacteria, or having viruses, or having pesticides, or having environmental toxins, or having molds, or even candida and yeast, or having heavy metals like mercuries or leads or aluminums or cadmiums, or even things like plastics, BPAs, or having, we can even have parasites, and we can have, believe it or not, EMFs. Too much EMF exposures with our cell phones and our Wi-Fi and our Apple Watches, all of those things are creating an increased demand for cortisol. So ultimately what happens is we only have a certain amount of pregnenolone in a day to handle the stress responses. So the body is very, very intelligent. What it will do is it will say, okay, I'm going to cut off the supply to all of these guys here, and I'm only going to go into cortisol from progesterone. In fact, progesterone can also go to this side of the equation as well. So it gets a little bit complicated, but at the end of the day, what you need to know is as your demand for stress goes up, then your supply tries to keep up with it by stealing away the raw materials that you would otherwise use for your sex hormones, like DHEA, testosterone, estrogen, all of these things that are necessary for reparative nature, libido, energy, strength, vitality, vigor, all of these things. And so what typically happens is you start to see cortisol levels go higher, and you start to see DHEA levels go lower. And ultimately, we should have a 5-to-6-to-1 ratio of DHEA to cortisol. And when we're in a chronic stress response, because we're starting to steal the raw materials of DHEA and we're helping cortisol levels go up, then you'll start to see the ratio of DHEA to cortisol go up as well. And that's when we know we have a chronic stress response. Then what we do is we start to look on this side of the equation. Is testosterone low? Is estrogen low? Is estradiol low? Is estriol low? If all of those things are being impacted, what typical doctors will do is they will give you hormone replacement or some kind of patch or some kind of troche, but they don't address all of the causative factors of cortisol demand. And so that's why doing a gut repair, a food sensitivity test, bacteria testing, parasitic testing, fungus testing, heavy metal testing, environmental toxin testing. We use some homeopathic preparations in our office to try to test for that. And once we address these things, then we are able to reduce the demand for cortisol, and we're able to shunt back the production of DHEA so that we can allow the body to restore itself. So a lot of the questions I get with my patients is, what is a good cortisol boosting supplement? And I'll say to them, the best cortisol reducing supplement are the things that reduce the demand for your body to have to make cortisol to keep up with the demand. So trying to remove gluten and dairy and soy from your diet, or trying to make sure that you stabilize your blood sugar equally throughout the day, try to get a nice healthy representation of a protein, a carbohydrate, a fat, so that you are creating a nice even blood sugar levels throughout the day and it's not crashing too low. Other things that can cause an increased demand are psychological stressors. So things like your job or your boss or finances or your children or loans or your in-laws, all of those things are very, very difficult to change. But if you can address the way you're tolerating those or dealing with those or allowing them impact you, that's going to have a huge effect on your steroid hormone pathway. Sometimes what I'll do, though, is when I see someone's DHEA go very low, or some of these hormones over here go very low, then I will make a recommendation for pregnenolone or DHEA. But I never do it based on someone saying, hey, I'm tired all the time. Should I take DHEA or pregnenolone? The answer I tell them is, I don't know. We haven't seen a saliva sample yet. And I'd like to know how much of your stress response has created a reduction in cortisol or a reduction in DHEA. It's like a dance. They dance around together, and we don't really know until we test and say, okay, well, your cortisol levels are high. You look pretty good throughout the day, but your DHEA levels are low. So at that point, we would typically try to control the demand for stress, but also maybe give a little bit of support with DHEA. Or we may see all of these things be really, really low and progesterone be really low. And then I'll say, okay, aside from eating more healthy fats, maybe we'll give you some pregnenolone help and short term, not long term, so that we can give you a little bit of a shot in the arm so that your hormones are producing at better levels than they were before. And then when we retest, we can see that the body knows how to redistribute these building blocks for hormones more effectively. So hopefully we got your head spinning a little bit, making you think a little bit differently. There's a lot of things that we can go over on a saliva sample, and I do this every day in my office. If you liked what you heard, then please give me a thumbs up to this video. Be sure to check out my blog at your Adrenal Fatigue Society, and I hope that you found this episode very interesting. Thank you so much.